pathways to impact statements for grants for fellowship. If you're ever going to apply for your own money, what sort of advice would you give to early career researchers with regard to filling in that type of document? So if they have to say what impact their research is going to have and they don't know where to start, what should they do?
Would anyone like to take that first?
Any advice?
So I recently filled out for the very first time a postdoctoral fellowship. An impact statement, it's quite weird because you're trying to imagine some non-existent science currently, and you're trying to imagine what impact you can say with that. And it goes into two strands, essentially. There's the, this research is going to make loads of money and we're going to commercialise it strand, which I totally ignored today. And then there's the science communication strand, which would be things like saying you're going to go to a science festival, which is quite easy to say you're going to do a science festival example. Harder to say you're going to do things like press releases. But you can say things like you're going to put your research out there as preprints, or you're going to do a blog series. We were talking about blogs at the conference earlier. It's totally valid to say that you're going to blog your research as you go along, maybe once a month, or you could even tweet a day in the lab every so often, or you could do things like, for example, in the fellowship application I put in, I said I'd really like to start a particular podcast about biophysics, which is my research area, because I've looked at nearly all the science podcasts out there, and there's very little in that particular area, and I think it's a really hazy and not well understood area of what defines biophysics. Anyway, but the point is, you can be creative with your science communication when filling out one of these things. With one of these impact statements, and I think there's a danger that people aren't very imaginative with what they can do with their science communication, and they just turn it into a box-ticking exercise with saying, oh, the university science festival, and science festivals are good, but if they only say, oh, the university science festival, you know, maybe make a web page, it's not particularly engaging. And I think these plans, you write the plan when you submit the funding application, and as far as I can tell, it's never updated, and you could be applying for 3 years worth of funding, and we know how quickly plans go out the window these days, so I would like a more agile approach, and especially as you bring new team members into the lab, people come and go from a research lab and they have all sorts of skills.
I think what I would add to that as well is, as an early career researcher who's applying to these things and who's worried about how they're going to talk about impact, you're not alone. You're allowed to ask for help. I would say that in terms of absolutely anything you're doing as an early career researcher, please go talk to people, look online, talk to your supervisors, talk to any mentors you have in the research group or beyond, postdocs. People have a whole wealth of experience in doing this and in doing it well, and you are not by yourself in it. You can always ask for advice and for help in these areas, whether it's a public engagement style thing or almost anything else.
And any other comments from the other two there on that? Or you can just also just throw it open to the floor, so getting hands in the air as well, but if you guys would like to. Michael?
I think it can sometimes be hard to write an impact statement. It's a skill within itself. So yeah, I think I'll echo that. You should ask people who have written them time and time again. And certain people, certain funders are looking for certain things. And so there's also, you know, ways to think about it tactically as well. But I think, yeah, really use other people to help you guide that.
My question is mainly to Rachel and to Lewis. I totally agree with everything you say about empowering researchers to communicate their science. But we've just literally heard about how difficult it can be sometimes to know how impactful, really, your science is going to be when you communicate it. So I'm going to adopt just a devil's advocate position, because actually I totally support everything you were saying. But devil's advocate, not all research is interesting to the public. So I know it's shocking, I know, but how do you go about, you know, if you are a researcher, you're uncertain whether this communication is actually going to be just good for your funders or good for the whole public, do you think taking a step back and explaining why the area of research rather than the nitty-gritty might be one way to communicate, or how would you advise people to really make that impactful to, you know, Joe Public, who, you know, may care about curing cancer but doesn't care about developing the newest surgical implement, for example?
That's a very good question. I should say, I talked a little bit about undergraduates as science communicators. Sorry, can everyone hear me?
Right,
yes. Okay.
Sorry.
So, you're talking about a more broader picture of science, and obviously a lot of science communication from early career researchers is focused on the research that they're doing. But I think, yeah, taking a step back, talking about broader areas is really beneficial. And I briefly mentioned undergraduates as science communicators. I think undergrads, for example, they have a really broad knowledge of their subject area, and I think they can be, actually be really good science communicators, just because they haven't been slaving away in a lab for 3 years working on something very specific doesn't invalidate their experience and their way of explaining things. But what you say, to take a step back, I think this is why formats such as Becky mentioned, like Science Soapbox, are so important, because you're probably going to be talking about a wider type of research where people can ask you questions about various different things in your field. There are also some other science communication formats that we haven't mentioned today, things like Bright Club, which do research comedy, which are pretty engaging in a totally different way, and you tend not to get bogged down in the details of your research, but you're talking about your research in general and sort of making it funny and engaging as well, that maybe some of the other panel members can jump in.
I agree with everything Lewis has said. I would add sort of two things. Firstly, if you're wanting to measure the impact of your public engagement, you should be planning that right from the beginning, right from when you're planning your event. You need to think about how you're going to measure that impact. Are you just going to count people? Are you going to ask them to fill in surveys? I've seen things where they had like kids like colouring things in and posting them through post boxes to say which things their favourite part of an event were. But you need to plan that ahead of time, and you need to know how you're going to measure the impact, because sooner or later someone's going to ask you, so after you did that, what happened? Did people like it? Did anybody learn anything? And if you're not asking that question, you're not planning to ask that question from the beginning, you don't know the answer to that, and then you're going to have a hard time asking funding for the next thing. The other thing is, if you're, you always need to know a little bit about your audience. You need to pitch things carefully to your audience. So when I go and give events about gravitational waves, if I'm talking to sort of late teenagers, I will talk to them about things like black holes and galaxies and things. If I come into contact with a 5-year-old, I'll go, do you know how gravity works? Should we jump up and down for a bit? And that's a lot more fun for them, because they don't want me to start deriving calculus on the blackboard. They want something that they understand in terms of their day-to-day life, and when you're 5, that's jumping up and down. So you do need to know who your audience is, what's important to them, what their background is, what they're already interested in, and you need to tie it into what's relevant to them in their lives and explain to them why it's relevant to them. And then you can get a bit of excitement.
Can I just go to the point on metrics of engagement with science communication? A few years ago, I attended the British Science Association Science Communication Conference, and a huge focus, they had several sessions on this, was figuring out how effective your science communication has been. And Becky mentioned a bunch of metrics. There's some casual ones, like asking kids to post like words that they associate with the event, or, you know, did they think it was good, simple things like that. But also, people who are professional, full-time science communicators, they spend a huge amount of time on their metrics. And as Becky says, they're set out from the start. Now, science communicators, people doing it as a sort of the equivalent of a Sunday fun run, they don't really think about that. And I think it's the professionals, people who are employed by science festivals, people who are on public engagement fellowships, it's a core thing of what they do and of a profession. And I think maybe if there was any way of making it easier for the people who dabble in science communication to use that sort of metric, that would be useful. But currently, I don't think there's a particularly good way for your average science communicator to get metrics from the audience without planning it well in advance. And maybe we should. Maybe we should be thinking about that right from the start.
So for the people who've never been involved in applying for funding, who've never had to write an impact statement, are those, what are they asking for? I mean, are they asking for metrics? I mean, how much guidance do you get from filling in the form?
Oh, right. You get very little guidance, and they're not asking for metrics. They're just asking that you do stuff. So that's the stage we're at, is sort of doing stuff and box ticking is the stage that we're at, and I think that needs to be developed further as well, because it can be done so much better.
I would argue though that even if the people providing the grants aren't asking for detailed information and metrics and statistics, it's still helpful for you as a communicator to know what events have worked and what haven't. And not everything, I mean, if you're doing a sort of a hobby level, like Lewis said, fun run type event, it doesn't have to be super detailed. I've had events where I've given a talk and then I said, would you mind putting your hands up if you learned something new today? And I'm like, oh, that's about half the audience. Okay, half the audience learned something new today. That's my impact. And sometimes it can just be that level. It doesn't always have to be high level statistics or anything like that.
Okay, we've got time for maybe one more question. There's a hand up there at the back. There we go. I will take your hands. If you just shout. And then I'll
get
it back to you.
See, this is a great afternoon with three talks that focused on getting recognition and showing the impact and taking the research to the hard-to-reach audiences, communication and all these are measured for metrics. I think there are simply too many metrics. As a microbiologist, which one should I care about? ResearchGate metrics or Google metrics or ALP metrics or Scopus metrics? Should that be a module in the beginning of a PhD?
So too many metrics, not knowing which ones to pay attention to, and a difficult, complex area as well, of different ones, and it's going to go into a little bit this afternoon, but maybe go back to Anne.
So the short, easy answer is there is no one metric. There never will be. A metric is not enough. If you want to be in a world where a number sums you up, I don't think it's a world most people want to be in, and I think that's a good thing. And so the reason there are so many metrics is because one is not enough. There are flaws with the metrics we have. There are flaws with the processes that are built on these metrics. So it's part of the evolution. There's experimentation going on, if you like, with what works. Knowing and giving your feedback about what works for you as a researcher when it comes to metrics is a helpful thing. Be part of the conversation and influence the change, so that we can all make science, including science metrics and including not using metrics where it's not appropriate, part of the picture.
Well, it's a difficult one because I also think there's too many metrics. it is a case of, I think we're at the stage of, we understand that the metrics that we're using thus far aren't the be-all and end-all, and so there is a lot of experimentation going on. So there's things like old metrics, which I think are more like indicators rather than the metrics, but then there's citations, which are a tangible thing that you can say is marking impact. So I think you're just going to have to be involved in a lot of them at the moment as we work out what the best way is to measure somebody.
Okay,